Okay, it's a long story. It goes back a longer time. Yeah, well, that's just one of the many songs that celebrate golf. What we're going to look at is how golf started, which was a long time ago. It's older than the US. Women played a more significant role in developing this game than most people realize. And the competition has always been there in a way, but it is radically different now from the way it was earlier on. And we are used to the idea that a golf course has 18 holes, but there is no rule that says a golf course should have 18 holes. And the reason why it has 18 holes, we'll find out about that. And the golf hole is a certain size for the strangest of reasons. And we'll try to get into that as well. This is what the game is. A golf ball, as you probably know, is a fairly hard thing, and that's basically it. Get it into the you know, all the various holes in the course with as few strokes as possible. It's pretty simple, really. But it started off in all sorts of places and in all sorts of ways. Down here, we have a game that the ancient Romans would have recognized. So it looks as if people have been hitting stones with sticks for quite some time. There's a French version, and this is the one that Scotland pretty well developed. That's the name. But here's another name from the Netherlands and Denmark, or maybe it's the other way around. Maybe this is Denmark, and this is the Netherlands. But it's been known in various stages under various names. And Scotland is the kind of place that has long had links with Europe. We have tended to have more links with Europe than our neighbor to the south, who has tended to have more wars with Europe. So it's not too surprising that games from Europe came back to Scotland, or versions of them. This is a pretty early version of golf. You can see down here somebody ready to strike something, probably a stone, and somebody over here is pointing the way for him. And you can see it's winter. This is on a frozen canal or a frozen river. Here's another one. This fellow's well into his swing. The ball, you can see, is perched up on something. These days we would call it a tee. And this looks like his playing partner here. In the background are people playing or doing archery and various other games. And then here's another one from the Netherlands area, a golf pose in the foreground that we would all recognize. Here's somebody further back sizing up a shot, looks as if he's a left-hander, playing with maybe a son who also has a club in his hand. And clearly they're on ice because here they're fishing for ice, or maybe they're just taking ice out to keep drinks nice and cool. So what was early golf all about? Well, the common factors in early golf was that it was a winter game. Bear in mind, we're talking about a time when during the summer, everybody was busy trying to grow food or catch food and get it ready to store for the winter. But once you got to winter, the ground was too hard to plow or do anything with. There weren't any crops to harvest. Animals could see you because there were no more leaves to hide you. So in the winter, you had time in a way that you didn't have during the summer. So whatever the ancestors of golf were, they were winter games, and they involved clubs of some kind, usually bits of wood, and a ball or a stone of some kind. And the aim was basically to hit it from a start point over an agreed distance or to an agreed target. It might be a barn door. It might be somebody's house. It might be a milepost halfway between one village and a next, or it might even be the market square in the next village. And the general rule was the fewer strokes you took, the better. What we did in Scotland was to take that single big long distance and divide it into a series of holes. And that's really the modern game now. So let's look at early golf. One of the things that seems to have influenced golf in Scotland was this battle, a battle that nobody's ever heard of, but it was a battle when the English were fighting the French. When were they not fighting the French? But the Scots on this occasion went over to help the French. Why wouldn't we? You know, we've been battling the English at one thing or another for centuries. So the Battle of Bourges was fought and the Scots came home, and that seems to have increased the popularity of golf, so much so that by 1457, it was so popular that the King of Scotland, James II at the time, banned golf on Sundays, and then a few years later banned both football, we would now know it as football, and golf. Football, you'll bear in mind, is called football because it's a game where you hit the ball with your feet. I know that in North America you have a game where you play it with your hands and you call it football, but this is the original football. And in 1502, not only was the game so popular that the ban on golf was lifted because people didn't like not being able to play golf, but the king ordered a set of clubs. He was playing golf too. So it's been a very popular game for 600 years, maybe more. It's referred to in a letter in 1513, and golf on the Sabbath was deemed acceptable at one point. Nowadays, we don't worry too much about that kind of thing. And an English king, Charles I, was playing golf when he got news of this uprising, and, well, he finished the round. So clearly golf was a major attraction for him, much more so than tackling an uprising in what at the time was a pretty remote part of his kingdom. But here's an interesting lady. This is Mary, Queen of Scots, in 1567. This is just a few days after her husband, Lord Darnley, had died in a mysterious explosion. But here she is playing golf. And of course, the courtiers are out there. You don't go anywhere without your courtiers. And to the side, to the right as we look at her, are a couple of young men who are carrying clubs and generally looking after her as she's out on the golf course. These would have been young potential officers or young officers in training. What do we call a young officer in training? Well, we call him a cadet. That's the French, from the French meaning to carry. And it's from that that we get the word caddy, the person who carries the golf clubs of a professional golfer and is the one person that a golfer can consult for advice. But the term goes back to Mary, Queen of Scots. By the mid-1800s, golf was becoming pretty popular. This is partly because railways were being built, and that allowed people to travel in ways that they really couldn't before. This is the period when seaside resorts in Britain and all over Europe became popular because people from the cities, which were usually fairly industrial places, they could get down to the coast, to the seaside, and do things like play golf. I can't imagine being able to hit the golf ball very far dressed the way these ladies are, but clearly they were out there enjoying the game. This is the first professional golfer, Alan Robertson. Now, golf in those days was something like horse racing. People bet on who would win. And if you placed the right bet and your person won, you could win a lot of money. But the golfers didn't any more than the horses do in a horse race these days. And that's one of the things that the golf professionals eventually stood up against. A professional in those days was the man who made the clubs, made the balls, and would play in competition, certainly, but only so that the gentlemen of the day could bet as to see who would win. And first of all, the golfers said, well, wait a minute, that's not fair. Why doesn't the winner give us a percentage of his winnings? And eventually they got rid of the whole thing and they simply played for money as they do now. But because he was the best golfer in the world and recognized as the best golfer in the world at the time, his death in 1859 prompted a competition to find out, quite literally, who was the best golfer in the world. So the idea was that they would ask all the best golfers to show up, play a competition to see who would succeed Alan Robertson as the best golfer in the world. And the meeting was held by the men of the Prestwick Golf Club in Scotland, and it was held in this very building, the Red Lion Pub, and I suppose it's a little hotel as well. And this street is the main street going through Prestwick, and on the side of the building, just there, is a board that commemorates the fact that inside this building, the gentlemen of Prestwick Golf Club met to decide on and decide the first open golf tournament in 1860. Because it was the first, it's known to this day as the Open Golf Tournament. Any other golf tournaments that sprang up had to be identified. So there is a French Open, there is a German Open, there is a Swiss Open, there is a US Open, but there is only one Open because it was the first. And I can recommend that. I've got a son who lives maybe 10 minutes walk away from this place, and they do good meals in there. So if you get over to Scotland, go to Prestwick. You can't miss the Red Lion, and anybody will tell you where it is. It's within a drive of the golf course at Prestwick, and you can go in and see the place. I think it's been repainted and redecorated since 1860. But there's the first open golf tournament. And the first few tournaments were played in St Andrews, which by then had 18 holes. Prestwick at the time had 12 holes, and Musselburgh, which we'll hear a bit more of in a minute, at the time had 9 holes. So there was no standardization when the first open golf competition happened. On the left is a thing called a feathery, which basically it's somewhat similar to a baseball. It's very heavy. It is smaller than a baseball, but it's heavy. And if you ever drop a baseball on the floor, you'll notice it doesn't bounce. Neither did the feathery. It's basically a leather sack filled with feathers, and you do it when the leather and the feathers are wet, and you stitch it all together, and as it dries, the leather shrinks and compresses it in a not hugely predictable fashion. A professional could make 3 or 4 of these a day, so they were expensive. Relatively easy to repair in a sense, but they were expensive. But in 1848, a missionary from Scotland had some stuff sent to him from India, and it was enclosed in a rubbery substance that he realized would make an ideal golf ball. And people changed to what became known as the gutta percha ball, which is basically a sphere of rubber. And you could mold this and make balls much more quickly, and they bounced and they ran rather better. So they were also cheaper. However, we have to appreciate that the game in those days had some technological difficulties. You probably recognize this gentleman, Tiger Woods, and the trophy he's clutching there is the one that you win at the Open. It's the claret jug. And one of his best drives, I think he's possibly exceeded it since then, was 425 yards. That's with a modern set of clubs and a modern golf ball. But go back to this gentleman, Samuel Messier, and way back in 1836, he drove a feathery for 361 yards. Now, admittedly, it was winter and the ground was kind of frozen, and that helped him, but to do that kind of distance with a wooden club and a feathery ball was quite a feat. He must have been a lot stronger than he looks, and I dare say he did it rather earlier than when this photograph was taken. This is the home of golf these days. This is St Andrews. The town of St Andrews is down here. And you see this triangular patch, which looks something like a dorsal fin of a shark. This is an area of sand. It's useless. You can't grow anything on it. It's a sand spit that has built up over time. You can see farmland down here, but this area is basically just wasteland. And it's owned by the town, and it's always been the place where golf was played. It's actually owned by the town as well, so it's public property. You can go there and you can happily walk on these golf courses. Just don't get in the way of the golf, but you can walk there. If we zoom in on that, we can see that this thing, we've tilted it round a bit, but here's our big triangle. And you can see six golf courses. And this one here, this hook-shaped one, number one, this is the one that's called the old course. This is the one that golfers would give their back teeth to play on. And you can play on it. What are your chances if you're a tennis player of being able to play Wimbledon? What are your chances if you play US-style football of being able to play in one of the big, where's the Super Bowl this year, Tampa? What are your chances of being able to go and play in that stadium? In many sports, you just can't get to these places, but anybody who has a sufficient handicap, you have to be reasonably good at the game, but you can play this old course. And in the height of summer, it'll cost something about $260 for the game, for the round of golf. In the winter, this time of year, it's probably something like $130, but you can play it. The course was originally 22 holes. And if you look here at the fourth and the 16th, share a green. So you're going from the third to the fourth and you play onto this green. And when you're coming back, you play onto the same green, but now it's the 16th. And so the flag, there's a flag at the other end. So there's a flag at each end, not quite each end, but there's two flags on this green, which slows down play because you can't really play onto this green from either direction until whoever's there has cleared it. And with 22 holes and the game increasing in popularity, it just became too slow. So they shortened it to 18 and they changed the order so that instead of starting here and going out this way, they started down here and they now go this way. So these days the course looks like this. We've twisted it round so that it's in its true orientation. So here's the first and we go out that way and then we come back in this way. And we're going to spend a wee bit of time looking at this area here because the Open next year is at St Andrews and you'll see some of these areas. Well, this is the town. And here's the first tee, and you play in this direction over a road, right over the top of a road. This is the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews. We'll see that, you know, there's the pillars in front of it. We'll see a few more shots of it. And this is the Grand Hotel, which was a hotel originally, then became a student's residence for St Andrews University, and I think it's now converted into apartments. When it was a student residence and the Open was here, the students would line the windows and stand on all sorts of perches in order to see the play because there's a grandstand here. So up here, you could see over the top of the grandstand and see all the play and see the players come up here onto the 18th green, which sits in there. If you're a golfer, you'll know that the 18th green at St Andrews has a trough in front of it, the Valley of Sin. And you don't want to go in there because it makes your finish very, very difficult. This is a slightly different view. We're looking higher up. And I want to draw your attention to this hole in the ground here. This is the 17th green with a wall running alongside it or behind it. And the 18th tee is here. And this is the Swilken Bridge. This is the Swilken Burn, or stream, snaking its way down to the sea. And there are actually three bridges across it, because obviously if you're playing the first, you come down this way to the green, and you cross this one. But on your way to the 18th, this is the one that you cross, because you're playing to the green just up here. And this is the Swilken Bridge. It's world famous in the golf community, so much so that many other courses have built their equivalent. If you watch the Masters, for example, you'll see that they have a bridge that looks very similar to this. The thing is so famous. And the reason I'm standing there shivering is because it's cold. This was January. So it was about this time of year, a few years back. There was a wind blowing, much as there is just now. And it was a Sunday. which means that nobody is playing because they're doing course maintenance. And on a Sunday, anybody who wants can wander around this course. Now, you respect the course, so you don't wander over the green or anything like that, but you can wander the course. And if I just go back to this for a moment, here's that road that you play over on the first. This is a public road. Actually, the whole area is public property. It's owned by the town of St. Andrews. So it's public property, and people regularly drive their cars this way across the course. Especially when it's busy, there will be somebody at each end basically saying, hang on for a minute because somebody's just about to play a shot this way and we don't want the ball to go through your car window. They're not there to stop you, they're just there to pause you so that you can cross safely and so that the golfers cross safely. It's traffic control, but this is a public right of way right across St. Andrews. I don't believe there is a public right of way right across Augusta, where they play the Masters, or most of the golf courses that are used for the US Open. But this is St. Andrews and it's owned by the town. This is the hole in the ground that I pointed to earlier. This is the 17th green just here with a wall behind it. And this is a bunker. If you play golf in the US, you might be used to golf to bunkers being fairly shallow little scrapes in the ground with a bit of sand in them. So much so that professionals over here very often play into a bunker on a course because it gives them an easy, predictable shot out onto the green. But if you're playing St. Andrews and you're playing the 17th and your ball ends up there, you've got to get that ball to go nearly vertical to get out of here. You're not supposed to go into bunkers. They're supposed to be a hazard. They're there to make life difficult for you, not easy for you. So the idea that it's just an open scrape and that you can play into it deliberately because it makes for an easier next shot, that's not really in the spirit of this game. This is just a quote that I thought I'd throw in at this point because, as far as I'm aware, that's pretty true. You can't be thinking of how that you swing. You just have to get on with it. The oldest club that we know of is this club formed in 1744, the Honourable Company of Edinburgh Golfers. They still call themselves that. And they first of all played on Leith Links, then they played at Musselburgh, and they now play at Muirfield, which is one of the courses that is used for the US Open. The Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews came along 10 years later, and it is now the ruling body for world golf. And when the Honourable Company of Golfers started, this is roughly how they dressed, and this is how they went about their business. You'll see that there are no golf bags. They're just carrying a set of clubs. And although it's an Edinburgh company, I think this is actually Stirling Castle. Just below Stirling Castle, there is an area which to this day is a golf course, and it's known as the King's Course. And this looks a lot more like Stirling Castle than Edinburgh. So I think there's some artistic license here. But this is certainly roughly how golfers would have looked back in 1744. And you'll notice there's a woman there. I don't think she's playing, I think she's just wandering about, or maybe her husband is one of the players. But in 1811, golf was being played by the fishwives of Musselburgh. They were the women who gutted the fish as it came ashore from the fishing boats. These were working women, and they worked hard. Now, this is not the trophy they played for. This is a very stylized, the Barbie doll version. And in fact, they didn't play for a trophy. They were given the winner was given a fish basket and some silk scarves. But it eventually became a trophy. But it's the first example that we have of a trophy of any kind, an award of any kind being given for ladies' golf. And so in 1811, this was the working women of the port of Musselburgh, the women who usually travelled the country gutting fish as it came off the fishing boats. And this is Izette Pearson, who was one of the founders of the Ladies' Golf Union. By this time, people, as I mentioned earlier, were travelling around by trains. And there was a problem with golf. And one of the problems had been, although it had largely been sorted by this time, one was the rules of golf, but the other was how do you compare golfers of different standards? It's fair to say that if I went to play tennis with any professional tennis player, they would slaughter me. There is no way that my lack of skill can be compensated for. But in golf, there is. It's called the handicap system. And actually, it was the women who developed it. Before that, the clubs tended to have their own little handicap system. So if you were a golfer in Brantford and you wanted to see a friend in Madison and you wanted to play golf over there, the Madison handicap system would not necessarily be the same as the system in Brantford. And the ladies found that this was really not acceptable. And so they were the ones who formed a handicap system. And essentially, the handicap system we have now is the one that the ladies invented back in 1893. And golf, we just don't see this these days. These days, the spectators are marshalled, but here's the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St. Andrews. We saw it earlier with the pillars in front. So the first tee is over here. The 18th green, it looks as if people are on the 18th green. And this is the Scottish Ladies Championship. And this looks as if it's somewhere around maybe the turn of the 1900s into 1800s into 1900s. It's pretty old. This little bandstand thing is there to this day, as is, I think, this building. Craig Stadler's a well-known golfer from not too many years ago, but I think we can all recognize the frustration implicit in this little quote. And this is the place where you'll find the oldest surviving golf clubhouse. And this is the course. It's in the middle of Edinburgh. And there are the pins marking the holes. You'll see that they're not terribly far apart because this is not a place where you go for long drives. This is a public park. So there could be a couple of kids playing football over here. There could be a family having a picnic over here. There could be somebody walking their dog right here. But you can play golf on it as well. You just all have to make room for each other. And people have been playing golf there for a very long time. This is the clubhouse itself, at least the lower part is. And if you go up close, you'll find this above the door, Bruntisfield Links Golf Club. Bruntisfield Links Golf Club. And if you go there, you're playing on the oldest golf course that's been in continuous use for several centuries. And this is the oldest surviving golf clubhouse. Most have been relocated, rebuilt, but this one is still there as it was when it was built. We're going to look at a couple of classic courses. St. Andrews sits in there, and just across the water from it sits Carnoustie, which is another legendary golf course. Both of these golf courses sit on that triangular piece of land, or on separate triangular pieces of land that are not used for anything. They have no agricultural value whatsoever. And so that's the obvious place to put a golf course. In the case of Carnoustie, the golf course shares that triangle of land with the army, who have shooting ranges on it and exercise assault courses and things on it. But up here is one of the golf courses when the professionals know that the Open is at St. Andrews or any of the Scottish golf courses. They very often make for Royal Dornoch to get some practice in. Carnoustie and Royal Dornoch, like many, in fact, nearly all golf courses in Scotland, they're privately owned. The members own the course. They're owned by the members. They're not owned by companies. They're not part of big resorts. They're owned by the members. There are some municipal courses as well, owned by the town or city. And Royal Dornoch is a private club. To us, a private club simply means that it's owned privately by the members. It doesn't mean exclusion. Anybody can go and play Royal Dornoch. There's the most exclusive course in Scotland is Muirfield, and it's exclusive only in the sense that there are only a couple of days when they allow visitors. But every club in Scotland allows visitors. So you can play anywhere you like. weekends are often difficult. Very often they'll say no visitors at weekends in the summer because that's when the members are available and they like to keep the course for that. Or there might be a couple of days in the week when you might not be able to play, and certainly not a day when they have a competition. But other than that, golf courses in Scotland welcome visitors, private clubs, but that doesn't imply exclusion at all. And this is Royal Dornoch. And this is a links course. This is a classic links course. All that you're seeing there, all that vegetation is sitting on top of not much more than sand. And the sand has ripples and heaves and hills and hollows. And so the golf course designer has to work round all these hollows and bumps and so on. You don't bulldoze this into shape. You take what nature has given and you work with it. But you'll notice in the foreground, one of these deep bunkers, you really don't want to go into that. And look at this thick, tussocky grass. You really don't want to go into that either. And if we look in the other direction, again, here's these bunkers. So if the ball rolls in there and up to that face, it's going to be very difficult to get out onto the green. But look at this stuff. This yellow stuff here, this is all gorse. This is prickly gorse. The ball goes in that, and you're probably, well, you might see it, but you're certainly not going to be able to play it. So there's the penalty. And it seems strange on this side of the Atlantic to have golf courses where the fairway is manicured like a carpet and the grass to the side has to be a certain height and only. This is the kind of jungle that you want to be trying to play. In golf course, you're playing only three opponents ever. In golf, you're playing the course and you're playing whatever difficulties the course presents. The second opponent you have is the weather, whether it's windy or not, whether it's raining or not, snowing even or not. And the third opponent you have is the space between your ears. And that's it. You don't play the other person as such. They can do nothing to change your game, unless the space between your ears lets them, and you can do nothing to change their game. So that's one of the attractions of this game. Jack Benny was known to be keen on golf, but only apparently up to a point. Let's just go back a wee bit to 1860. There's the first Open Golf Championship. And in 1893, the Ladies' Golf Union was formed. And it's about this time that a couple of things happened. There had been some rules of golf earlier, but in I think it was about 1870, the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews came out with a fairly comprehensive set of rules of golf. This is a time when travel meant that people could move and play sports. So it made sense to have the same set of rules of golf for every golf course around. And so golf courses generally adopted the rules as formulated by St Andrews. A similar thing happened with football. Villages had their own rules, but once you began to be able to travel and you went to somewhere else to play football, it helped if there was one set of rules that everybody played for, that the goalposts were the same size, the pitch was the same size, and so on. And so a football association was set up to standardize the rules of football and the dimensions of the pitch. And that football association gave rise to what was briefly known as soccer football, a term which survives on this side of the Atlantic. In the rest of the world, it's simply known as football, the game you play with a ball and your feet. I still don't understand why it's called football over here, but it is. But that's a digression. 1895 is when the first US Open was played, and oddly enough, it was played in Rhode Island. But one of the things that was happening at about this time with the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St Andrews having 18 holes, that became the standard for golf courses, certainly for competitive golf. There are still golf courses that have different numbers of holes, and I don't mean nine. There are golf courses that have 12 or 13 holes, and that's fine. You just can't run a proper competition on them. You need 18 for that. The other thing that happened about this time is that because the game was getting more popular, the greenkeepers were having to change the hole every so often. The hole would be dug in the green, and as more and more people played, the grass would get flattened and they'd have to move it somewhere else so that the grass could recover. And they were having to dig those holes with little trowels. Well, that's kind of awkward. So one of them went to his local blacksmith. And in those days, blacksmiths were the people who made golf clubs, so they knew about the game. And he said, I need something better than just a trowel to dig holes on this green. And the blacksmith thought about it and looked around. And at this time, cities were growing hugely. Urbanization was taking place. The cities were growing. And there was a huge demand for drain pipes to drain the water off the roof. And drain pipes in those days were made of cast iron. And so this particular blacksmith took a length of cast iron, cut a short length of it, cut teeth in the bottom of it, welded a handle on top and said, try that. So the greenkeeper went and pushed this thing down into the ground, turned it so the teeth would cut into the ground and lifted out a core, like an apple core of soil. And by creating another hole, he could easily bury the hole, the core that he'd just taken out. He could easily put it somewhere else. And suddenly it became quickly and easily possible to change the position of the hole on a green. And the shape, the size of that cast iron downpipe, rain pipe, is the size that golf holes are to this day. A simple tool, but a strange sort of history. Once we get into the 1900s, golf is becoming fairly popular. A dimpled surface ball. We pick up a golf ball and we all know it has a dimpled sort of surface. The scientists explain to us why the dimples help the ball to fly further and better and so on. But that really only dates back just over a century. And the first golfing US president, we're used to golf, to US presidents playing golf, but that too is barely just over a century old. And this is the man who really lit up the game in the USA, Francis Ouimet. And he won the US Open back in 1913. The thing is, he wasn't a professional golfer. He was just an ordinary working man who liked golf and happened to be very good at it. But because he won, everybody else realized this is a game I can play and maybe I can win too. And so his win in 1913 really opened the floodgates of golf in the US. When he was playing, clubs had names. I think this is one of the things we've lost in golf. You know, isn't it nice to be able to say, you know, I think I can use a niblick to get this thing on the green, or I think I could maybe spoon that. And now we've got numbers. I blame Slazenger. They started the mass production of golf and started numbering the clubs to make them more easily identifiable. And in a way, I suppose that makes a wee bit of sense, because a niblick was simply a club made by the local blacksmith and there was no standard to it. So the niblick that I might have from my blacksmith here would not necessarily be the same as the club that you're playing with made by your blacksmith, even though they're both called a niblick. These days, pretty well any 7-iron is built the same way. So my 7-iron, if I can play it properly, I can send the ball just as far as I might with your 7-iron. But there's a bulger. You know, hand me my bulger, caddy. Hand me my mashie. I think we've lost a wee bit of romance from the game by going to numbers. We're taking this up into just the early part of the 1900s. The Professional Golfers Association, the PGA, just over a century old. And by 1921, the Royal and Ancient, the world governing body, and the US Golf Association, which governs golf only in the US, but the rest of the world follows the Royal and Ancient Golf Club's rules. And they fell out over golf balls, and they've fallen out over one or two other things in the years since. The Masters competition that I referred to earlier dates only to 1934, so it's not even 100 years old yet. But in 1935, Jean Sarrazin won this Grand Slam, the Open and the Masters. And the ladies began to play much more seriously by 1944, well, basically in the years after the Second World War. I want to look at one little course in particular. And this is a little place called Tinault in the Highlands of Scotland. And this is a golf course that I helped to build. There had been a couple of golf courses there before, but World War I had put an end to one of them, and then they built a different one, and World War II put an end to it. And then in the late 80s, they were able to acquire this piece of land and start building a golf course. And there are the first five holes. And then down the edge here is number six. And I'm happy to say that I had a hole-in-one on the sixth at Tinault, and it was the first hole-in-one in competitive golf at Tinault. So destroyed me that the seventh, I think I took eight for the seventh, so my overall score wasn't all that great. But this is it in its very early years. It's hard to even recognize that it is a golf course. At this stage, we'd had to cut down a lot of trees, and we did it ourselves. I was out there with a chainsaw at times. I was out there digging ditches at times. We didn't really bulldoze anything. We didn't have the money to do that kind of thing. But more recently, it looks something like this. And again, we can see the layout, and you can begin to see the trees have perked up a bit. We planted a lot of trees to delineate the fairways. There's the sixth where I got the first hole in. Did I tell you I got the first competitive hole in one at the sixth at Tinault? There's seven and eight, and we can get a better view of number nine coming back. It's a what we call a dog leg, a bent hole. In the early days of this course, we parked down here where the parking is for this little sports field, where they play football and shinty and so on. And we usually had to walk here. But now you can drive to a little car park here. And now there is it's a sort of big shed, but it is actually a clubhouse. In the early days, we simply had a small garden shed here with an honesty box. And most of the time, it's still an honesty box. There's a notice that tells you how much to pay, and we expect you to put the money in the box. There are many golf courses in the Scottish Highlands that still operate on that system. You turn up, put the money in the box, and you go off and play. Sometimes there'll be a greenkeeper who might ask, have you paid? Very often there isn't. And there's my closing quote. Apparently even Billy Graham can't summon more hope and more help than he naturally has available to him on the golf course. So there is the story of the development of golf. And I think I've answered all the questions. I've explained how women had quite an important role in early golf and the reasons why it has 18 holes and the reason why the golf course, the golf hole is the size it is. So if I haven't persuaded you to take up the game, at least perhaps I've explained some of the origins of the game and persuaded you that it is not a rich man's sport. It never has been, except in the US. It is the game of the man in the street. Indeed, when I started playing golf as a teenager, I could always tell when the local plumber was playing, because in the distance you could see him. You know that plumber's bag they carry with all the pipes horizontal? That's what he used to carry his golf clubs. It looked rather more like the 1744 version than the kind of things we have. And I should also point out that golf is a game where you walk the course. If you walk the course, you can feel the wind in your cheeks, you can feel the gusts, you can feel the direction, you can feel the landscape under your feet. If you play in one of these carts, it takes longer. Believe me, it actually takes longer. Yes, you get quicker from tee to green, but the time you take messing around at the tee and the time you take messing around at the green slow you down. Walking is the way to play this game.